on mute, sorry. Sorry guys, I was on mute. For those of you who are new to TechAthena, TechAthena is a platform where we discuss about cutting edge or bleeding edge technologies. Technologies which are going to affect your data center or the way you are going to work. So with that, I am your host Deepti. Today's topic is on a graph AI. AI is changing every day. So at present, we are at narrow AI. Okay, that is we are applying AI to one application or one task, that is for face recognition, speech detection, or object detection. But our aim right now is to move towards broader AI, that is to add ethics to AI, fairness to AI, or security and linearity to AI, lineage to AI. But our ultimate aim is to go to a general AI, where AI learns like a human by themselves. So with that, I would want to introduce Kuntal. Kuntal is from IBM Research. He has 16 years of experience. With that, over to you, Kuntal, again. Please let us know background about you and how you have come into this field. And yeah, and how is your experience been? So that our viewers get to know you more.
Thanks, Deepti, and good morning, everyone. Thanks for inviting me to this session. I'm pleased to be here. So, yeah, I had, as Deepti said, I've been like around 16 and a half years in the industry. Before that, I was doing my academics from Jadavpur, then IIT Bombay with computer science. So I started off as a software engineer, but then over time, back in 2007, I moved into IBM Research. So my master's, I did AI. I used to do natural language processing and that, AI techniques for that. And then over time, when in IBM Research, I started working on social network analysis, and that involved graphs. So eventually, I was exploring courses and I was like learning stuff. And then eventually, somewhere 2014, I attended a course in IIT Delhi, which was specifically about this topic, graph-based probabilistic graphical modeling, and that got me interested in graph AI also. So what I'm going to cover today is mostly an introductory talk to probabilistic graphical models, which is one of the foundation stones of graph AI. So my journey over time just took me here. My background on AI and also my background on graph, some of those two got married and I came here.
Okay. Can you give us a little bit brief of today's session and what you'll be covering? Maybe a little brief before we go more deeper.
Yeah, sure. So today I shall introduce a bit about graph AI, because while quite a few of us would know it, but I'm sure there will be somebody or the other who might encounter this for the first time. PGMs, at least probabilistic graphical models, which is the main thing that I'm covering today. Okay. So I'll give a couple of applications, and maybe some model types, directed, undirected models, Bayesian networks to a little extent, a very brief introduction to Markov networks, and that's probably going to be the direction today.
Okay, Kuntal. Okay, then with no further delay, we are going to start off with the session. So hold on. I'll put the session through.
So hi everyone, and thanks again for being here today. The subject that I'm going to cover today is a simplified introduction to graph AI, graph artificial intelligence, via probabilistic graphical models, or PGMs as we call it. So in the flow of the lecture today, what I'll do is I'll very briefly introduce graph AI and point you to a couple of fundamental questions that the subject is built upon and a couple of places where it can be applied. Now there are directed and undirected graphical models. So if I take a step back, the subject is actually a mixture, an overlap, I would say, of graph theory and machine learning. So it's a pretty specialization topic, high specialization subject, and it's not frequently taught in most of the colleges, definitely not in India. It's only a few colleges that teach this. So I'm pretty sure some of you will be helped by the subject, if you find this interesting, and I'm sure some of you know this. So I'm expecting an audience that will be a mix of the two. Now that said, the directed and the undirected graphical models come from the graph theory side of the things. While if I look at the next bullet here, the generative and discriminative models, these are from the machine learning paradigm. So, the whole subject is based upon probability, and we start with two fundamental rules of probability, chain and Bayes rule. And from there, I go to Bayesian networks, which are directed graphical models. There I define conditional independencies, and before that your random variables independencies. By the way, the term independencies is fine. That's how the community pronounces it. There's no spelling mistake there. It's actually pronounced that way. It's not a traditional dictionary word. It's given that way. So beyond that, I'll go to what we call deseparations, and all of that is under the purview of Bayesian networks. And so that's the part where I'll be technically on the deeper side. Then I'll very briefly touch upon what I call undirected graphs, factorization there, and Markov networks, which is where the undirected graphical models take off from. And pretty much that's what I'm going to cover today. So that said, let's move on to the content. What is graph AI? I'm pretty sure everybody has heard of AI, artificial intelligence. There's nobody in the CS and IT related community that don't know of it. It's to make machines more intelligent. They can respond intelligently in unforeseen situations. Graph AI is a graph-based mechanism to attain the goal, right? So it goes over and beyond the graph analytics. It models the problems involving probability and uncertainty using graph techniques. Now, traditional AI attempts, if you know them, they involve in uncertainty, except for the fact that in graph AI, it's sure it's a vehicle to solve the problem, but one of the elements that it brings is the graph side of things, right? So in graph AI, one of the main areas of graph AI is probabilistic graphical models. It's a very broad and deep area. And today, that's what we are going to focus upon. You can have, discrete reasoning based on graph, and there are other schools of analytics, but PGMs is what we are going to focus on today. And it's going to be a very brief introduction. Now, graph AI can be used in many domains, NLP, computer vision, image processing, pattern recognition, etc. And PGMs can be used in all of these. So what is a PGM? A PGM is a graph-based AI model that factors in uncertainty in many forms, right? So graphs, if you know, they have got vertices or nodes, and then they have got edges that connect the pairs. Now, in traditional graphs, you'd also know there's a question of weighted and unweighted graphs. The edges might or might not have weights, and directed versus undirected. So the edges might be directed from one node to the other or may not have a direction. Now in graph networks that are constructed as part of developing probabilistic graphical models, PGMs, the edges can be anything. They can be directed, they can be undirected, but often enough, there'll be either node level probability or have an understanding of information theory. Now, the fundamental questions that people tend to ask in this paradigm is how to represent a model, how to have a concise and compact representation of the large number of probability distributions. And what is large? I'll go there very soon. At least I'll take an example. It's not feasible to exhaust in a short talk, but I'll take some reasonable examples that will give you a sense. The concepts involved often enough are conditional independence and marginalization. And I'll talk a lot on conditional independence. I won't talk much today on marginalizations, again, due to the limitations we have, the limits. Now, the next thing that people have been researching on is how to draw inferences from probabilistic graphical models. For example, given a set of observations, what is the probability of X having happened? Explainability, what is the most likely explanation of something that you have seen is happening? How to draw samples? If there is a huge data set, how can you draw the right set of samples to keep up the distributions, etc.? But this actually spans beyond PGMs. This is elsewhere also in all kind of data science, at least most kind of data sciences. And given observations, how to make decisions. So those are covered under inferencing. In learning, how do you create the model structure? How do you do parameter learning? And sometimes if some part of data is missing, can you approximate the data? So you can first have an approximation and then learn based upon that. So handling missing data. So these are some of the basic brief questions that you ask in PGMs. So today I'll mostly focus on a couple of model representations, and mostly the directed ones, as I said, right, through Bayesian nets. There are several applications, and over the next few slides, I'll just give some pictorial and intuitive views, but I'll just spend a minute on that because there's a lot to cover. So, but apart from the examples I'll give here, there's a lot more to cover. It's much more wide. So you can have speech recognition, and there's something called hidden Markov models and the generalizations that can be used for this. You can have robot tracking and robot localization, and here are some example of papers that were published, also PGMs, right? So these are examples of Kalman filters, etc. You can have evolutionary biology through Bayesian networks. Then modeling sensor data. So I'm sure you'll be able to correlate at least something or the other with something that you probably do in your daily lives if you come from the tech background. Then how do you make decisions and plan under uncertainty, like, you know, DBNs, then dynamic Bayesian networks, then factored Markov decision process problems, etc. Then image processing, right? I mean, there are several techniques really. This is just one randomly picked example. And I actually picked these examples from, you know, I've acknowledged the end, but I chose to give some examples that are often covered in CMU, the Carnegie Mellon University. So yeah. Then there's structured data analysis, which, you know, has got text, there's web pages, right? And the examples go on. So here are some examples from the natural language processing domain. So, you know, here's a n-gram, n being four grams. So how do you select the tth word given some age? When you have already selected, you know, I mean, that's like determined by the previous three words, because, you know, you are creating a fourth word. So yeah, just WT minus one, WT minus two, WT minus three. Given these three things, how do you select the fourth word? And there are more, you know, you can have interpolated unigrams, bigrams, trigrams. You can have mixture trigrams. I'm not going to go in these details because there's, you know, these are just two examples for you to touch upon. Now, there are directed and undirected graphical models, right? As I've been saying, so directed models will come with directed edges and will create directed graphs, right? Like Bayesian networks, which I'll cover in detail today. And then these are mostly, you know, directed acyclic graphs, which essentially means there'll be directions, but there'll be no cycle. You know, you cannot come, if you follow the direction of the edge, you cannot come back to the point that you started from. And then undirected models with undirected graphs, so the edges are undirected there. The examples of that being Markov networks, which are often applicable on such graphs. Now, again, to move away from that, I know I'm touching upon just. So generative models and discriminative models. Generative models, the job there is to generate observation X given C. So C is given and you try to find the probability that X is, you know, you try to generate X, and, you know, and then you try to compare with the ground reality if you could generate what actually happened often enough. Or in a pure generative model where that there's nothing to compare from, you know, you could probably do some prior learning and then used, you know, different maximization algorithms. And then there's discriminative models where you find the most likely C given an observation X. So the arrow, the difference in these two diagrams, if you notice, in the first one, generative models, the arrow goes from C to X. In the next one, the arrow goes from X to C, because there you have seen X, you are trying to find C in the right hand side, right? So it goes from what you have seen to what you are going to find. So at a very brief level, so the job of a discriminative model is to discriminate between the different choices. You know what could have happened, and you try to find what has most probably happened out of the few things that could have happened. So that's what a discriminative model does. So to carry on, now I'll start entering the Bayes paradigm. So what is the chain rule and what's the Bayes rule? So these are two fundamental rules of probability. Chain rule is probability of alpha and beta, that is, you know, to both alpha and beta to have happened, equals to probability of alpha multiplied by probability of beta given alpha. So if you take an example of real life, what's the probability that, you know, two things have happened together? That's exactly equivalent to guaranteeing that something has happened, all the cases that has happened, the probability of that, and then finding the case where the other thing has happened, right? So it's an intersection case. Let's take an example. What's the probability that, you know, you took, you know, let's say, what's the probability of a die? Let's say you're, you know, rolling two dice. What's the probability that, you know, the first one showed three and the second one showed four? So that's exactly the same as the probability of the first one to have showed three independently, and then the second one to have shown four, given that the first one has shown three. If you do the math, you'll find the probabilities to come exactly to the same, right? Now you can generalize that to what I have shown just below, right? So probability of alpha 1 dot dot till alpha k is probability alpha 1, probability alpha 2 given alpha 1, and so on until probability alpha k given alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 dot dot alpha k minus 1. So like if you take probability alpha 4, it'll be probability, as in the probability of alpha 1 to alpha 4 is probability, the last term will be like probability of alpha 4 given alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and so on. Right? And then there's a Bayes rule where you have got, you know, probability of alpha given beta, which is probability of beta given alpha, probability alpha by probability of beta. Now that's actually pretty easy to see. If you look at it, I could write this equation slightly differently. I could say probability alpha given beta times probability beta. And if I move the right hand side p beta in the denominator to the left side, obviously it goes up to the numerator. And then the right hand side becomes exactly the numerator, which is probability of beta given alpha, probability alpha. So you know, I mean, it's just a different way. If you look at the numerator, it's just a different way to write probability alpha and beta, right? So if you look at the top, it's precisely that. And again, you could generalize it like you did in the previous case. So if there's a gamma, so you can say probability alpha given beta and gamma is, as you see there, right? So it's fairly intuitive from the previous. So I'm still defining things. Let's understand what's independence and what's conditional independence. So alpha and beta are independent if probability of beta given alpha is probability of beta. In other words, the two probabilities are exactly the same because beta happens agnostic of alpha. It doesn't matter whether alpha happened or not. I mean, the event corresponding to alpha happened or not. Beta is going to happen exactly in where it happened, right? Which is why the alpha is ignored, right? Intuitively, it's like two independent events. You know, now it's going to rain no matter what cloth I'm wearing today. So it doesn't matter whether I'm wearing a brown shirt or a blue shirt. It's going to rain. These are really independent events. Well, I don't know. If I'm going outside, no, I could be wearing a different shirt, but let's not take that into account. So what is interesting in here is if you look at the symbol, that's the independence symbol, you know, what looks like an inverted T, like a T upside down. That's what we call the independence symbol, right? So you have to please keep this symbol in mind. We'll use this symbol a lot of times downstream. So alpha and beta are independent if and only if probability of alpha and beta equal to probability alpha, probability beta. By the way, these are very basic statistics, very basic probabilities, probability theory. So I'm like sure most of you know this. So I'm like touching upon this very briefly. But if you don't, do look at this, but I would suggest you go and, you know, do a basic 101 of probabilities. And then alpha and beta are conditionally independent given gamma. If the following holds, is probability beta given alpha and gamma is exactly the same of probability beta given gamma, right? So what it means is, this, that, you know, the probability of beta to have happened depends on gamma, but is independent of alpha in a way. So in other words, alpha and beta are independent given gamma, right? So if you know gamma has happened, alpha and beta happen independently. And this again will be used many times in today's talk, these properties, this conditional independence. We have a whole section on this. Now probability of alpha independent of beta given gamma happens if and only if the right hand side of this thing holds. Probability alpha and beta given gamma is probability alpha gamma, alpha given gamma, probability beta given gamma. So these are all conditional independences, right? So here are some basic, you know, properties of independence. They are symmetric, which is, you know, X and Y are independent given Z, which is exactly equivalent to Y and X are independent given Z. You can decompose them, you know, so if X and Y, X is independent of, you know, Y and W given Z, X is independent of Y given Z. Weak union, as you see in the next one, then contraction, intersection, right? But intersection can happen only for positive distribution. So where the probability of alpha is greater than zero, alpha being, you know, anything, any of these elements is greater than zero. By the way, so I of P, we shall use this notation I of P to have the independence properties that are entailed by P. So far what I've been giving is some background knowledge and I've been just touching upon. Now here is where I'll start going deeper, because here is where I start entering the first type of PGM that you will see in, you know, some of you will see. So this is Bayesian network, and of, you know, it is dependent on the it uses the Bayes rules, etc., etc. But we'll see how. So the general challenges of representing network information completely is given below. Let me go there. So we want to represent, let's say, the joint distribution P and take a set of random variables X, which is X1, X2, all the way till Xn. Now, pretend Xi are Xi being X1 to Xn, pretend they are binary variables, right? So they can take two values. The joint distribution, so if you see there are n terms, right? And each of them can take two values. So there needs to be 2 to the power n different numbers, right? So there are 2 to the power n different assignments, right? And that, if you notice, is exponential, and hence it's unmanageable, right? It's computationally prohibitive, and it's cognitively also difficult because it's a huge size, and you cannot contemplate them, right? Because, you know, if you look at actual numbers in terms of probabilities, they'll become extremely small, right? Because they'll have to add up to one, so it becomes extremely small. Now, all of this makes the probabilistic methods of computation impractical, because, you know, you cannot really cognitively comprehend them, right? So the PGMs came along and solved this problem. You know, I mean, how to represent this in certain cases and how to compute with this, that's a lot of, you know, that is one of the main stuff that PGM addresses. Now, independence properties of distribution is what will lead to compact representations of high dimensional distributions, right? We'll see Bezier networks, which are directed acyclic graph, DAG in nature, that provides a general purpose modeling language to exploit such independences, right? So there'll be independence of property, independence in distribution, and we'll use Bezier networks to exploit that independence to make these things much more manageable. So let me again touch upon a very basic, you know, very basic background thing, right? What's an independent random variable? So independent random variables have this, okay, not exactly a definition, but it's one of the core defining properties though. So probability of x1 and dot dot till xn, if all the x1 dot dot till xn are independent, will indeed follow probability x1, probability x2, dot dot till probability of xn. And in absence of the independent structure, the problem needs 2 to the power n parameters to represent the joint distribution, right? Now, if you look at the left-hand side of this, you know, the p of x1 dot dot till xn, the space is exponential, 2 to the power n. And, you know, so all the probabilities there, p1, p2 dot dot till p2 to the power n, it's in, you know, R being real numbers, so it's being in R2 to the power n space, in such a manner that the probabilities need to sum up to 1. So P1, P2, P3, dot dot till P2 to the power n, they need to sum up to 1. And I'm pretty sure you see, as n increases, this the individual values of the probabilities keep decreasing, and they become extremely small and practically unmanageable for humans to really, you know, make sense out of that. I mean, what sense are you really, in all real cases, what's the difference that you'll really make out between 0.000057 and 0.000519? Even though one is 10 times of the other, they are not very, they don't look very, you know, attractive, practically speaking, not for the human cognition. Now, the right hand side of, you know, this equation, px1 dot dot till pxn, if you can, you know, since these are independent, you could actually express this in terms of only n parameters. You did not need 2 to the power n, because these are n independent distributions, right? Px1 is one distribution, px2 is a second distribution, then it's just only n distributions with one, these things, you know, one variable. So that's much easier, right? The key concept here is you have got independent parameters, and this x1, x2, x3, those are independent, and that's why you could decompose this into the whole left hand side into what you see in the right hand side. And that independence parameter leads to this favorable outcome that, you know, you have got this thing here. So using this as a background, let us go to what we call a conditional parameterization. Now let's take a real example, and, you know, I've taken this example from a very very popular professor Daphne Kuller of Stanford. The example comes from her material. So this example is very interesting, and this example, please follow this, because, you know, we'll be extending upon this example for the next, I don't know, maybe 20 minutes. So I don't know how long, but, you know, a lot of it is on this example and extension of this. So let's take an example where a company is trying to hire a college graduate, George, let's say, or whatever. Now, the company would, how does the company hire? They would try to find the student's intelligence, right? But the company has not interacted with the student, so there's no direct way. So what's the best option for the company? Try to guess how intelligent the student is, right? So what is it? How can they start? I mean, they need something. So let's say the company is given an access to the SAT exam score of the student, right? So here is some evidence for the company. Oh, the student scored this much in the SAT exam. Now that gives them some information, right? Even if it's not a complete detail, they start getting a sense. And now let's say the intelligence of the student is represented by I, right? And this is the SAT score of the student is S. Now let's say, no, again, to make the example extremely simple, let's say there are only two values, right? So let's say intelligence can be I0 and I1, I1 being highly intelligent and I0 being a low intelligence. And similarly, let's say S1 being a good score and S0 being a not good score, bad score in the SAT exam. So very clearly there are four entries, right, for I and S. So when I, if you look at the table below, you know, this is I0 and S0. And let's say the probability of I is in some instance is 0.665. I0, which is in a low intelligent student scoring a, how do you say, this is like a good marks. So that probability is pretty low, 0.035. High intelligence student scoring bad in SAT, that probability is also quite low. And a highly intelligent student scoring badly, scoring reasonably in the SAT is 0.24. So the first intuition was, you know, a student with not much intelligence having a poor low score in SAT. And of course, as you can imagine, that probability is high, right? So if you look at the intuition behind these numbers and the intuition that I0, S0, I1, S1, they represent, you know, they have a correspondence, right? They have an intuitive correspondence. I mean, you do expect a, you know, poorly intelligent student not to have a really good marks in an exam, and a poor, you know, the chance of a not very intelligent student scoring a high marks in an exam is even lower, and so on, right? So that's what this represents. So that's a conditional parameterization, right? So you know how intelligent the student is, then you are trying to say, oh, given the student's intelligence is high versus low, what do I expect? Is the student going to score a good marks? Is the student going to score a bad marks, etc., right? So that's an expectation, right? That's a condition. Now, if I go back here, you see this is exhaustive. It looks at all the possible values of I and S together. Now, if I go one slide back, if you see the left hand side of the equation, px1, x2, xn, you know, which has a whole, the entire joint distribution together, that's precisely what this table represents, the entire joint distribution together, right? Now, how much can I separate them out? Let's try that, right? Now, before I go there, think of it. Look at the very first line of this slide. A more natural way of alternative representation would be probability of IS equal to probability of I, probability of S given I. What does that really correspond to? The probability of the student being intelligent, or whatever the intelligence level of the student, and then the probability of scoring some kind of a SAT score given the intelligence, right? So because the intelligence is more fundamental in a way, right? I mean, the student goes with some intelligence, fundamental in the sense, you know, maybe, I don't know, it's temporally fundamental, maybe. I mean, the student goes with some intelligence, right? You don't change that. They sit in the SAT exam with their high or low intelligence, whatever it is, right? And then they have a, you know, some sort of an outcome, good outcome, bad outcome. So it is a factor of the intelligence, and that's precisely what this equation in the first line, the right hand side of the first line, is going to capture, right? And which is what I've explained here. Now, mathematically, this is very significant. Why so? Because if you look at the right hand side of this, we are moving away from the joint distribution PIS and trying to represent this over two distributions, PI and P of S given I, right? So that's not a joint distribution anymore. The first one, PI, that's an independent prior probability distribution over I. That's why I said, you know, it comes like, you know, in a way temporally before. It's more inherent in some sense. And the second one is the conditional probability distribution, or CPD, of S given I is already known, right? Now the CPD of PSI, that represents the probability that the student will succeed in SAT in two possible cases, right? One, okay, what is given? The intelligence is given. So what are the two values of intelligence? So one, when the intelligence is low, what's the chance of succeeding? And two, where the intelligence is high, again, that's given to us, or whatever the intelligence value is given, we'll know it's high or low. And what's the chance of succeeding given that level of intelligence? So we are using three binomial distributions, right? The probability of I, which is an independent distribution, then probability of S, which is S0 and S1, as in capital S being small S0 and small S1, given the value of I is 0, and similarly the value of S, oh, I'm so sorry, this should have been a capital S, there's a typo here. So the probability of capital S given I equal to 1. So as you see, this can be parameterized using three independent parameters, which is theta I1, as in theta I being high, right, and theta of S1 given I1, and theta S1 given I0, right? So these three things. And by the way, so moment you say theta I1, as in theta of intelligence being high, the fourth one, which is theta of intelligence being low, you don't really have to have a parameter for that because you know it's 1 minus theta I1, right? So theta I0 is anyway 1 minus theta I1. You don't need a separate parameter, which is why three parameters suffice. You don't need four here, right? So the expression is more natural though than the complete joint expression. Now, if you look at the tables I've created, I0 is 0.7 and I1 is 0.3. And by the way, 1 minus I1, which is 1 minus 0.3 is 0.7, right? And that's the left-hand side table. On the right-hand side bottom, the table says the value of I0 and value of I1, right? So when I is 0, as intelligence is 0, S0 is 0.95 and S1 is 0.05. If you sum it up, it becomes 1, you know, the row wise. And similarly, if you take the next row, the value of I is 1. So S0 is 0.2 and S1 is 0.8. Again, if you notice, they sum up to 1. Essentially, given some intelligence level, what's the chance of doing well versus doing not so well? So to carry on, now I'll go over to the naive Bayes model. So let's extend the earlier example, right? So far, what have we seen? If I go to the slide back, the company could access the intelligence level and the SAT score. Sorry, the intelligence level is determined by the SAT score in a way, right? Now what we are saying is the student's grade point G in some course, the example I'll give down the line is Econ 101. So in some course is known, or for example, let's say that's the most relevant course for the job profile. Maybe that's known. So then what happens? So far you had two random variables, I and S. Now you've got a third one, right? G has also been introduced, the grade point. So pretend I and S are what were before. Now grade G, let's say there are three possible grades, G1, G2, G3. And let's say G1 is a high grade A, G2 is a medium grade B, and G3 is the low grade C, right? And here no independence, you know, can really hold, right, by natural intuition, because if you look at it, these things cannot be independent. I mean, clearly, if you look at a real life situation, clearly the student's intelligence will be correlated with the grades they get, and it will be correlated, you know, how well they do in the SAT exam and, you know, get a SAT score. So you really cannot ignore the intelligence, because, you know, you do expect it to kind of, you know, be proportionate, right, to an extent. By the way, the SAT score and grade again cannot be independent from the angle of a natural, you know, angle of natural intuition, because the likelihood of obtaining a good grade of a student who has a SAT score is higher, right? Naturally, because, you know, if somebody's SAT score is high, what do you think his grade is? Probably high, because, you know, it's probably a reasonably intelligent student, as opposed to a student with a low SAT score, right? So in other words, what do you expect? The probability of having a high grade, right, given a high SAT score is higher than probability of having a high grade given a low SAT score, right? I mean, if you take two students, tell their SAT score, oh, this guy has scored high, that guy has scored low. And then you say, can you guess what are their grades in the exam, who got a high grade and who didn't? Your answer is natural. The person you see to have a high value in the SAT score, you expect them to have got a good grade. It's very, very natural, very intuitive. The conditional independence property might still be satisfiable by the probability distribution P though, right? So if the student is known to have high intelligence, then the high SAT score doesn't mean anything, right? Because see, ultimately, the SAT score and grade both are effect of the intelligence, right? So if you know the intelligence is high, then a high SAT score, you know, so that does not give much information about the grade anymore. You know the student is intelligent, right? And sure, the SAT score and grade both are functions of that, right? So even if the SAT score is high, for some reason, I mean, you expect the grade to be high, sure, because you know the student to be intelligent, so you expect the grade to be high. But for some reason, the student might have liked the subject, they might have been sick during the subject. For many reasons, it could be low, the grade, but it's not very likely. So formally speaking, the probability of having a grade given I1 and S1 is exactly the same as having a grade given I1. Or it could be I0. No, I could just say probability of grade given I and S1 or IS, whatever, right? So generically speaking, if you look at the very last line, S and G, which is a set score and the grade, they are independent given I, because the moment you know I, that is sufficient for you to guess whether the grade was good or not and whether the SAT score was good or not independently. Without worrying, while guessing the grade, you don't need to worry about the SAT score. You know the intelligence is an indicator and vice versa. Now, if I continue, by simple probabilistic reasoning, what do we have? We have probability of I SG equal to probability of SG given I times probability of I. Again, the same logic. What you had seen before? Probability S given I and probability of I. What you had seen here, the first line right hand side equation. What you see here is exactly the same logic, just extended with G. Now, using conditional independence, which we have covered before, probability of, you know, SG given I is exactly the same as probability of S given I, probability of G given I. Why so? Because S and G are independent, right? So you can break this up. You can distribute this. Now, if you combine the first and the second equations, so pretty simply speaking, if you look at the first term here, probability of SG given I, that is exactly what, you know, this second term, you know, kind of expands. So you can rewrite this as what you have in the right hand side, probability S given I, probability of G given I, probability of I. So that's precisely what I have done in the third line. Probability of ISG equal to probability S given I, probability G given I, probability I, right? Thus, what you can have is that these three CPDs can fully specify the joint distribution, right? Now, even though we are talking of three CPDs, we have already seen two before. What have we seen? We have seen probability, the distribution of probability of I, the third term, and we have seen probability of S given I, which is the first term. So those two tables do not change, right? All you have to do is add the second table, probability of G given I. By the way, so that's like three independent tables. Instead of, if you look at this thing, P of ISG, this could have taken a lot of values, right? 2, 2, 3. So I suppose 12 values. So it's a larger table. And as you have more and more variables or, you know, terms that can have, you know, multinomial values rather than just, you know, two values, you know, things which can take many values. So there, this really blows up exponentially, and we are contracting, you know, we are like making, you know, compacting precisely that. Now, an example of CPD of PGI is given in this table. So if you look at this, given I0, again, you have to read row wise because the I, they are given, and the G's, you know, the grades, that's what you expect. So if the intelligence is low, the chance of a high grade is very low, 0.2, medium grade is 0.34, somewhere in the middle, and a bad grade is 0.46, which you expect, right? So you expect a low intelligence student to have a relatively bad grade. While if you look at the high intelligence people, I1, that distribution is skewed much in favor of G1 because you expect them to have a good grade. They are intelligent. They could still have a medium grade, but them getting a low grade is, you know, it's pretty low. The probability of that is pretty low. And that's precisely what this table represents. Now, if you take a numerical example, probability of I1, probability of S1 and probability of G2, which essentially means an intelligent student getting a good SAT score, right? And a medium, this thing, I'm sorry, again, there's a typo, it should have been G2, is 0.3, 0.8 and 0.17. So the 0.17 comes from here, G2, please read the third term as G2. It comes from here. And these other two terms come from the table, which has a couple of slides back, I1 and S1. So it's like 0.3 and 0.8. If you look here, I1 is 0.3 and S1 is 0.8. So these two terms. Okay, so this is where we are. Now let's generalize this thing. So that's a specific example. Let's generalize the naive-Bayes assumption. So given the observed features x1, x2, xn, these features are conditionally independent given the instances class. Conditional, like you have seen here, with respect to I, that's the condition. So more formally, xi is conditionally independent of x minus I for all c. So by x minus i, what I mean, and c is the condition, by the way. So x minus I mean everything in x1 to xn minus xi. So this is a minus except the xi. So based upon the independence assumptions, this model factors as P of C x1 xn x2 dot xn equal to P xi given c for I equal to 1 dot dot n, right? Now that said, let me carry forward. So here is a full blown example for the next few slides. So here is a full Bayesian network. So we have got a difficulty of a subject and D0 and D1. So difficulty 0 and difficulty 1. 1 is high, so high, difficult subject, the probability is 0.4 and 0.6 is easy. Here is the intelligence that you have seen before. Now here is a grade. The grade, if you think of it, is actually a function of what? It's a function of difficulty and intelligence, right? Hence, there are two arrows. So grade has two parents. One parent is difficulty, the other parent is intelligence. And if you look at the table, if it's, now let me see how this reads. I0 and D0 is what? I0 is a student with a low intelligence. D0 is an easy course, right? So it's a low intelligence student, but an easy course. So the grades, you know, high, medium and low grades are like, you know, they're fairly distributed over all the three. But if you look at the next line, that becomes more interesting. A low intelligence student is doing a difficult course. So what do you think is going to happen? The chance of getting a good grade is pretty low. The chance of getting a medium grade is medium. And the chance of getting a not good grade is very high. Let's flip the case. Intelligent student doing an easy course. What do you expect? It'll be a good grade, probably. Well, sure, it could be a medium grade, pretty low probability. And intelligent student easy course, it's very unlikely they'll get a bad grade. Now, intelligent student in a difficult course, again, it is fairly distributed. In this observation, you see it's 0.5. Half the times they end up getting good grades, but other half the times it's medium or low. So that's like, you know, common sense numbers, but I'll show you very soon how you can, you know, when you know something, how can you guess the other, you know, how can you form probabilities of the other. Now, again, if you look at the SAT score, that's a function of intelligence. And, you know, this is a table we have seen before. Let's not go into this anymore. Now, let's say that the student has to get a job. Let's say, you know, he goes and asks the teacher to get a letter of recommendation. So L0 and L1 with G1, G2 and G3. So if the grade is G1, what do you think the letter is going to look like? It's going to be a strong letter, so L1. If the grade is medium, it could go either way, right? It's up to the professor. They could give a strong or a weak letter. But if it's a poor grade, unfortunately, the letter is going to be weak. You know, it's not going to be a strong letter. So that's an example of Bayesian networks. Now we'll play around with the numbers a little bit. By the way, before I go there, here is how you can represent the network, you know, the probability of IDGSL, and you can make out what is what. I is the intelligence, D difficulty, grade, SAT score, and letter, you know, the first letters of the first alphabet of each of these terms. So probability, so what are the independent variables? As you see, difficulty and intelligence, so PI, PD, these are independent distributions. Now, when you come to G, it will be a factor of, it will depend upon, conditionally depend upon I and D, which you see the parents. You know, it essentially depends on the parents. If you look at PSI, P is given I, because S depends upon I is the parent, and P of L given G, because again, L depends upon G. So this gives an initial intuition. Now let me see how to do reasoning in this network. You know, I'll go into causal reasoning now. Now let's consider a few situations. The question being, how likely is the student George likely to get a good recommendation letter, you know, L1, from the professor in the subject, you know, this subject, let's call it Economics 101, Econ 101. So in absence of any other information about George, you don't know anything about George. You don't know anything about Econ 101. So it turns out from those tables, these numbers are, you know, 50.2%. By the way, I won't walk through the math, but because it's pretty hard to do in a small, you know, in a small time, short time, there are time constraints. But, you know, based upon the probabilities that you have covered here and the numbers that you are given in the tables, you can derive these numbers with a little bit of math. But I'll give the intuitions so you know that, you know, how to start thinking, because that's more important. Now what we discover is George is not too intelligent, right? It's I0. So if you discover that, then what happens? The probability of George getting a strong letter goes down. If you work out the numbers, it'll go to 38.9%, the probability being 0.389. So, by the way, now you discovered even though George is not too intelligent, the class is easy. It's D0, so the difficulty is low. then what happens? Then the chance of a good recommendation letter increases. Why so? Because that might have done well, right? And that's what ultimately influences the recommendation letter. By the way, so far I've never mentioned that explicitly. If you wrote the text here, I've never mentioned that. So hold this thought. This is going to come in interesting down the line. Okay. Now let's say that recruiter, and call them Acme Consulting, they are trying to decide whether to hire, and a priori they believe George is 30% likely to be intelligent. This is trivial. If I go back, intelligence by default is 30% people are highly intelligent, 70% are not. Hence, 30% they believe George is highly intelligent. Now, they obtain a record of George's grade in Econ 101 and finds its G3, C grade, right? So then it immediately crashes. They think, oh, George didn't get a good grade, so the intelligence must be pretty low. So the probability, again, if you work the numbers, the probability of high intelligence goes down to this. By the way, then what happens? That the probability that the class is difficult, if that happens, that also goes up in their mind. What I mean is, because of the fact that George has got this thing, a low grade, it also has this implication that this couple of this observation also makes them think, oh, the class could be difficult. 40% classes are difficult. Again, if I go back here, 40% classes are difficult. But working through our numbers, this comes to the chance of the class being difficult goes up from 40% to 62.9%. Now let's suppose Acme Consulting loses George's grade card, right? It's a pretty lucky accident for George because his grade was not good. But the professor's letter of recommendation has not been lost. Then the probability goes up a little bit. The probability of George having a good intelligence, because that plays a role in hiring, that goes up a little bit. As in goes up from the 0.7.9%, but goes down from the 30% of people having intelligence, it goes up to approximately 14%. But look at another number, and this is also very interesting. If Acme Consulting had both the greater grade and the letter of recommendation, the probability would still have been 7.9%. Take it to a couple of lines back. So when only the grade is known, the probability of being intelligence was 7.9%. Now the letter and the grade both are known, and this number is still 7.9%, and it's not a coincidence. It comes from a reasoning, and which I'll go to pretty soon. Now what happens is very interesting. George submits the SAT score to Acme Consulting, and hey, that's high. So that makes a difference, because to get a high score, you probably have to be intelligent. You probably cannot be so lucky, because you expect a written exam. So the probability of George to have high intelligence goes up hugely. From 7.9%, it jumps up to 57.8%. The probability is 0.578. So intuitively, what happens is the high SAT score outweighs the poor grade, because if you think of a real life situation, a student with high intelligence could still get a low grade. They might just not be interested in the subject, for all you know. They might have been sick. They might have missed an assignment because something went wrong, right? It could be any reason. But when you are scoring well in an exam, you are likely to be intelligent. So a student with a low intelligence is very unlikely to get a good SAT score. So so the inference now happens that the intelligence is not that bad. And let me get a couple of slides back. What happened to the SAT score? Here, the score went up. So all of a sudden, the expected value on the parent went up. Unlike the grade, when you had seen grade, it had pulled down the value of intelligence. Now seeing the other child of intelligence, SAT, the parent's value has gone up. So now let's say, by the way, a good student could easily still get a C grade, right? So the probability of Econ being a difficult class goes up even more. Why so? Because if the course is difficult, it's feasible that the student was good, but maybe the class was, the difficulty of the class still didn't make him or her perform so well, right? So that last pattern is also very interesting, because what you have said is the poor grade of George is actually due to the difficulty of the Econ class, right? Because we know that George has scored well in SAT. Let me go up again. So if you look at the trail here, George has done well in SAT, Hence, George must be quite intelligent. By the way, we know that George's grade in the class was not so good, but George is intelligent. So what can be wrong? Maybe the course is difficult. You see, there's a chain of reasoning. Even though SAT is not connected to difficulty directly, via this trail, we are starting to obtain a chain of reasoning which talks of a course being difficult based upon the SAT score. But if you think of, you know, if you think of it, the event of somebody taking a SAT exam, which is no way connected to the class, you know, I mean, that is supposed to be completely independent of a course difficulty, right? I mean, what a professor teaches in an economics class is no way connected to, you know, somebody going outside and taking an external SAT exam. But due to these relationships, that's what you have started connecting now. So, you know, here is where you have started achieving quote unquote AI per se, because you are doing, you are getting stuff which you only need some intelligence to do, because by default, by raw data, they are not really connected, right? And you are starting to have your beliefs. So those numbers, they create a belief in you. Is George intelligent? Is the course difficult? So that's probably the biggest takeaway from this whole talk, how to form beliefs on different entities based upon their connections and observations, right? Okay, so even more remarkable is, you know, let's say now George gets a B, G2 in Econ 101 rather than C. Then the probability of George being intelligent, it goes up. It goes up to 17.5%, right? However, if it's a difficult, I mean, we had seen this thing here, right? No, we didn't see 17.5, that was a slightly different situation. But by the way, if Econ 101 is a difficult class, then the probability of George being intelligent goes up to 34%. So that is, you know, probability of George being intelligent, given the grade 2 and difficulty is high, is 0.34. So this whole thing we have done here is called, informally it's called explaining away, and more formally, it's called inter-causal relationships, because here different causes of the same effect are being analyzed, right? So you are looking at the effect and then interacting via the effect, right? The effect was a bad grade, for example. The effect was a high SAT score. So these are effects. Now you try to determine what happened, you know, what happened to intelligence as a cause of SAT. Inter-causal, see, difficulty is a cause of grade. Intelligence is a cause of grade. So even though difficulty of a course has got no connection with an intelligence of a person, right? These are two separate entities altogether. But the grade is what connects them and starts causing intercausal relationships. When you observe grade, you start having joint assumptions, or rather joint beliefs, upon the difficulty and intelligence of difficulty of courses and intelligence of people. And when things move, when something changes from one to the other, the values of these beliefs keep changing. So let me go to the Bayesian network semantics. Okay. So some examples of independencies that hold in this example that we have given before. So the latter is independent of I, D and S given G. And I'll request you to keep the graph in mind. If you need, you know, if you need, you can just draw this thing once in your notebook. I'll give you a moment here, because it's not really feasible to draw the graph in all the slides, but I still have to take the examples. Then the next thing is the S, the SAT score, that's independent of difficulty, grade and letter of recommendation if the intelligence is known. Similarly, the probability of getting a high grade, and I'm picking pretty randomly, right? You could always keep constructing. So the probability of getting a high grade for an intelligent student in a difficult course, and given that there's a letter of recommendation given, that's always higher than probability of getting a high grade by an intelligent course and in a difficult course, by intelligent student, sorry, in a difficult course. Because in the left hand side, you know that there's a good letter of recommendation, so probably the student has done well there. G, independent of S, given I and D, right? So given the intelligence and difficulty, grade and SAT are independent. Actually, it happens because of I. I is the common factor which cancels things out, and we'll see very soon a causality. You know, there are four kinds of reasonings we'll do for indirect relationships, and G and S are indirectly connected. They don't have a direct edge, but they are connected via I in the graph. Then I is independent of D, which I probably mentioned before. How intelligent a student is completely independent of how a course somewhere is taught, how difficult it is, right? And then similarly, D is independent of I, as we have seen, but it's also independent of S, because a difficulty of a course is independent of somebody's SAT score, right? They're really independent. Now let's look at the semantics of Bayesian network. The Bayesian network structure G is a DAG, where if the random variables x1 to xn are the nodes of the graph, if PA, GXI are the parents of XI in G, and if non-descendants XI are the nodes in the graph that are non-descendants, as in not children or grandchildren and so on of XI, then G will encode the following independence assumptions, which we call local independencies, and are denoted by IL of, thing of G is IL of G. For each variable XI, XI is independent of non-descendants of XI, given the parent of given the parents of G in X, parent of XI in G. So what does this intuitively tell you? It tells that each node X is conditionally independent of the non-descendants if the parents are known. The local Markov independence is also precisely those, right? So this Markov is not to be confused with the undirected graph, this Markov, right? The term Markov might be a bit overused in general, but here it comes in the sense of locality. So it's the locality of the Markov, the locality property of Markov independences. So, and that holds here. So that said, what's an IMAP? So let's say P is the distribution over I, a probability distribution. So the IP is a set of independent asserts. IP is a set of independence that asserts of the form X independent of Y given Z holding in P. So P satisfies the local independences that are associated with G, and that can be expressed as ILG is a subset of IP. So G is said to be an IMAP or independency map for P, right? So P can be mapped into G, and G is said to be an IMAP of P if G is an IMAP for IP, right? So in general, let K be a graph, any graph object which is associated with a set of independences IK. So then K is said to be an IMAP for I. So if IK is a subset of I, right? So this is what the definition of IMAP is, but what you have been seeing so far is it's essentially it encodes a set of independences that exist, and any subset of that is a set of IMAPs, right? So let us jump the concept of this. Let us now come to a new concept and jump over from this to what we call a deseparation. And we are already seeing this, but I'll put it more formally now. Deseparation is a concept that's used to guarantee independencies, right? So far you've been seeing independencies. Something is independent of the other. Something is conditionally independent of the other, right? And I've been rambling through so many examples. Oh, look, when you have seen D, it's independent of S. When you have seen I, then your grade is independent of your SAT score. Oh, you have not seen I, and you have seen a high SAT score. Now your G, you can guess from the SAT score. So you can guess G. Why? Because I is not seen. So, it's like a lot of random things, it seems so far. There's no formal capturing right now, till now. So now I'll make it formal by the concept of deseparation and, in the trails. So there's something called a trail. If you look here, active trail, right? So I'll go to all of that now. So here we are trying to answer whether the independence X independent of Y given Z holds in a distribution associated in a Bayesian network. And to show that, we try to actually find the reverse cases, right? When does such a guarantee not hold? If we cannot find a reverse case, it holds. So now we come to the analysis below, right? So we try to construct a property. So how so? So in the first, so there are two ways we'll see. One is a direct connection and then indirect connection. So there's a direct connection here between X and Y. If you look at the diagram, right? So if X and Y are connected, there's an edge between X and Y in G, then you don't care where some other thing Z is. Z obviously I'm assuming is different from X and Y. So it's trivial to construct examples where X and Y are correlated, right? So for example, you create a distribution for X and then map to the observed distribution of Y, right? For on the domain for the value range. So all we are trying to say here is if X and Y are directly connected, there is a correlation. They are not independent. Now, if X and Y are indirectly connected, then that becomes more interesting, and that's what we analyze next. So in indirect connections, actually there are four kinds of indirect connections that we'll see, and two are, if you look at the diagram on the right hand side, there are two which are given here, right? So the first one, diagram number A, it causes what we call an indirect causal effect. And if you look at the XYZ structure over the X maps, X parent of Z, and that's a parent of Y. And if you go back to our example, it's exactly the same as IGL. Let me show it once. I, G, and L, right? So intelligence is a parent of grade, and that's a parent of letter. So X, parent of Z, parent of Y, right? I'm sure you can correlate. So let's go down here. Now I go back to the same example again. If G is not observed, you have not seen G, right? And your I intelligence is high. So then we are more inclined to believe that, you know, the student gets a good grade. George, he gets a good grade. Why so? Because it's an intelligent student, right? You expect them to get a good grade. And then what do you expect? A strong letter of recommendation, right? So you have seen that this thing is high. I is high. So you are saying the grade, this thing, is probably high. And if the grade is high, what do you expect? This is probably high, right? I mean, good, as a strong letter of recommendation. So L and I are not independent. L, which would be Y, and X, which would be I, they are not independent. It's, the independence is false. However, now let's say I've observed the grade, you know, the thing in the middle, which is Z here. Let's say I've observed that. So now L depends upon the grade, because in other words, you know, Y depends upon Z in this diagram. So irrespective of X, you don't care, right, whether the student is intelligent, dull, whatever. End of the day, they manage to pull a good grade, and the letter of recommendation is a factor of that, right? So then X and Y, or in that example, I and L, they become independent of each other. That's what you call a indirect causal effect. The fact that X influences Z influences Y if Z is not observed. But if Z is observed, then X cannot influence Y, because that influence comes via Z, and so it's right. So I mean, you see the trail, right? There's a question. I'll come to the formal notion of deseparation, but this is what forms the baseline of that. Now the other, so that's a causal effect. The X is a cause, Y is an effect in some sense. Now evidential effect, right? So you look at the same trail, IGL, right? But now let's say you've seen a strong recommendation letter L. You know, you have seen Y in some sense, the grade is not seen, then what happens? You think that the student got a good recommendation letter, so then the student must be having a high grade, hence the student must be intelligent, right? So that's how our thinking process flows. And hence you see that there is, right, the evidence that L was good makes us think that that G was good, and hence I was good, right? The evidence leads to a belief. By the way, if you happen to see the middle thing G, in this example Z, now seeing L doesn't mean anything, right? Now you know the grade. Sure, there will be some effect on L, but we are trying to see what happened to I. You have seen the grade, so you have a sense of how the intelligence is. Again, you, as we have tried said before, right? There is a distribution, an intelligent student could get a bad grade, and a low intelligence student could get a good grade. But generally, you have seen the distribution, and seeing G is sufficient to talk of I if IGL is the whole distribution, if IGL is the whole trail, right? You don't care about L anymore. It's only G that you care about. So here also, we conclude that X can influence Y via Z if and only if Z is not observed, right? To carry on now, so these are the first two. As I said, there are four types of trails. These are the first two. And these are the next two trails. So these are the common cause and common effect, right? So the diagram C gives a common cause. As you can very easily make out intuitively, Z is a common cause in this diagram. X and Y are effects, right? Now, if I go back to our example again, S, G, and I. See, S, G, and I. As you can see, this intelligence is like the Z. And between grade and SAT, they are like X and Y, right? So intelligence is a Z, and grade and SAT are effectively X and Y. And what are the cases here? The cases are this. So if you have seen that a high SAT score is given, then you try to think that, oh, it's probably a high grade, right? Because this is an indication that the intelligence is probably high. You have not seen the intelligence, and it's probably high. Now, or for example, if you have seen a high grade and you have not seen I or S, you see, oh, it must be a good SAT score because it's probably an intelligent student. That's the most likely case. It's not a guarantee, but it's the most likely case. Now think of the case where you have seen intelligence, right? And you have to guess about S. Does seeing the grade Z really matter? Not really. You know the intelligence, right? So you expect the SAT score to be our effect of the intelligence. You don't care about the grade anymore. And the same thing, right? If you have to guess the grade, again, you can guess from intelligence and other factors like difficulty, sure, but not from S, not from the SAT score, because SAT would only give you an intuition of how the intelligence is, but that's already seen. So what you see here as well, just like the two previous cases, like you have seen an indirect causal effect, you have seen an indirect evidential effect. The common cause case, third case here, creates the exact same situation, no difference. X can influence Y via Z if and only if Z is not observed, and vice versa. So by the first three cases, you are almost sure, oh, is it the case all the time? But no. When you look at the common effect, this is starkly different, and that's what makes the whole situation interesting. So this case applies, and if you look at diagram number D, that's where you're representing this. So this case applies when Z is a common child of X and Y, right? So if you look at the in our student graph, what you see is intelligence I and difficulty D are the parents of grade G. So you've got grade G, which is Z in the diagram, and you've got difficulty and intelligence. So now, if the grade G is observed, okay, so when the grade G is not observed, I and D are independent of each other, right? Because, you know, you have not seen anything. So how difficult is a course, some course, is impossible to connect with the intelligence of some student, because there's nothing that you can connect one to the other. But if you have seen the grade, so that actually corresponds to the case that you have not seen Z. So you cannot connect X and Y in this diagram. But let's say you have observed G. In this case, you have observed Z. So that's when we perform this intercausal relationship. So which you have seen before, right? The V structure. This intercausal relationship is a V structure, right, in some sense. I mean, sorry, this thing is a V structure. So this structure is a V structure, right? The probability that a student has a high intelligence, I, goes down when the student C has a C grade. But it goes up when the class is difficult, right? This is something you have seen before, right? So for example, in this case, right, you have seen Z. Now, if the value of Y is low, then what happens? It's like the intelligence being low, right? And you have seen G. So let's say G is high. I'm sorry, let's say G is low, right? So then if this is low, what do you think? This is hard to say. It can be anything, but probably a distribution, because the student is not intelligent. So that's probably the reason of the grade not being good. But if the student is intelligent and the grade is bad, what do you think happened? It's probably a difficult class. That's why an intelligent student might end up getting a bad grade. Right, so what you see here in this example is X and Y had an intercausal relationship, right? So you could find one from the other sheerly based upon the effect of the common effect they produced, Z. So the second last bullet here, and the interesting point to note here in the graph is, if you do not have information about G, okay, G here corresponding to Z, but observe the recommendation letter is weak, we can actually correlate that and in turn correlate. So since I don't have a diagram for that, let me go a couple of slides back to the diagram. What I mean here, you have not seen the grade, but you see there's a good strong letter of recommendation. Now what do you think happened? This probably happened because the grade was good. So what you do is, based upon letter or based upon this child, you can actually infer something on the parent, right? So that inferred value in turn impacts your estimates of D and I. The inferred value of G, or your sense of G because of the observation of L, impacts the values of your estimate of D and I, right? So there's a trail that goes upward back, right? So if you think of it, letter is actually a descendant of grade. So it's got a parent-descendant relationship, right? And that causes the effect. So to fill in, right, as I said, this structure, this last structure is called a V structure or immoral structure. So with this, I'll come to the final couple of definitions for the Bayesian thing. One is an active trail So if G is a Bayesian network, right? So X1, X2, X3, you know, there's a trail dot dot till Xn. And if Z is a subset of observed variables, then the trail is active given Z if two things happen, right? So for each V structure like you have seen here. So for each V structure, either Xi or one of its descendants are in Z. Like you saw just a little time back, while G was not in Z, the grid, the letter of recommendation L was in Z, right? And hence you could still create the trail based upon the impact of L on G. And then no other node along the trail is on Z, because that right actually breaks the trail. So note one thing though, the trail cannot be active if X1 or Xn are in Z, sorry. Right, so that's not a trail. So that I think is a definition that covers the definition of active trail. Yes, it does. Now with that, I'll formalize finally the definition of G separation. So if IG is a set of independencies and they cause to this disparation, so IG is X independent of Y given Z, all of this, such that separation, such that in the graph G, X and Y are deseparated given Z. That is, there is no active trail between X and Y. You know, I mean, the stuff that you have seen here, right? There's no active trail where there's a Z, right? So if that is true for all the trails, there's no active trail between X and Y through any Z, they are deseparated. And the intuitive notion of deseparation is simply that, you know, there is a direct separation. Because of, you know, all the Zs, X and Y got active trail separated out. So that covers what I wanted to cover on Bayesian networks today. So I'll give a very brief touch upon for undirected graphical models, because it's been already deep and long enough perhaps for a single talk. So I'll very briefly touch upon this and encourage you to read more when you get time later on at home or wherever, maybe follow up. So undirected graphical models are where the graphs, the arrows are taken away. There's no graph direction. So it's simply interpretation of structure. The inference is simpler maybe. Maybe the independent structures are simpler, but they're harder to learn, we'll see. And then some computations require restriction to the discrete variables. So what's a perfect map or P map? A G is a perfect map if all IP is in IG, right? And does every distribution have a P map? Not really. Because some distributions cannot be represented in a BN, BN being a Bayesian network, like you saw now. So for, you know, the independence in P, the, you know, A are independent given B and C, and B and C are independent given A and D. So if you look at this diagram, the B and C are not independent given A and D. Why so? Pretty obvious, right? There is a trail between B and C via D. Here though, A and D are independent of each other because B and C are not seen. The moment you start seeing B and C, that's when the independence, you know, kind of goes away. So you cannot have a perfect map for everything. Now, the independence is, you know, A independent of D given BC and B independent of C given AD. That cannot be modeled with a Bayesian network without extraneous edges, right? I mean, you cannot model them together. But you can model them in a undirected Markov network. So if I carry on, so you know, here is an example. And by the way, so these are not, if you look at the tables, they are not probabilities anymore. These are what you call factors. You represent them by phi, by etc. And they do not say, you know, this like more of affinity. They cannot sum up to one because they are not probabilities. Right? They are just numbers. For example, you could see, you know, just to take a random example, you could keep doing experiments and seeing how many times do it occur in a finite, and it could just be the count of that occurrence that you put in the table. So you have got, you know, this structure A, B, C, D. Now you see, you know, here is A and C, and here are the factors of A and C. So A0, C0 is 4 times, A0, C1 is 12 times, and so on. So you observe those, right? And you have that observation between AB, you have between CD, and you have between BT, right? So it's an undirected model, and you're trying to form factors where you try to find how kind of, you know, how is the affinity between these pairs. Now the representations, so this represents a joint distribution, right? So if you look at the unnormalized factors, clearly these are unnormalized, right? They don't go to one by any stretch of imagination in this form. So the factors are what? Pi of AB you can guess, right? There are four factors: AC, BD, and CDC. AB, AC, CD, and BC. Now, then there's a partition distribution. If you sum them up over all the ABCDs, what you get is a Z. There's a partition function. And if you try to have a probability, what you have to do is divide by this, right? Since a Markov network represents a joint distribution, they can be used for query answering. And, you know, it's just an example of what you can do, but you can do much more with that. And, you know, so here's how you construct this network. And the undirected network structure, so that's unlike, you know, you had a G, which is a directed graph in Bayesian. Here I've got an undirected graph H in Markov, and the X is XI, all the XI, you know, X1 to XN, they are random variables. And H encodes the independence assumptions. So a path X1 to XK is active if none of the XI variables along the path is observed, and a separator in H if there's no active path between this X for any X to any Y given Z, right? So that's called H separation. It's almost like a D separation, except it's H separation, you know, without a direction and so on, right? So pretty much that's the main difference. And a little more than that, right? So D is separate, as in separate from A and C both, if B is given. I'm pretty sure you see the similarity with what you had seen intuitively in the Markov, in the Bayesian network, right? So the global Markov assumptions is this. So X and Y are independent of Z, which implies this for all the Z. So can you encode all the independencies of Markov network? That can be, you know, so are the equivalent, you know, that's the question I'm trying to ask. Can all the independencies that a Markov network encodes, can that be encoded by Bayesian network? No, we have already seen, right? And is the converse true? No, you cannot do a V structure here. So they have their requirements, and you cannot have everything with everything. And with that, I'll wrap this thing up. Obviously, as I said, I just barely touch upon the undirected and Markov. There's a lot to read there. I have borrowed some of my materials, as I have said, from here. But of course, as you see, I have constructed some of mine, but here is where I've drawn some from. Feel free to read this up. And specifically, Daphne Koller's book on probabilistic graphical modeling is phenomenal. So I strongly recommend reading that. And thank you for everything. With this, now I'll stop my talk and open up.
Okay, so Kuntal, we are back.
Yeah, hi.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was a long session, but I really like the examples that you gave, Kuntal. Guys, just to tell you, this subject is as new to me, I mean, as it is to you. Kuntal is the expert here. I am also learning along with you guys. So, Kuntal, there's one example that came. Probably I also can start with the answering that. Okay. First one is Sanchali Rai is asking, can you tell us difference in traditional AI versus graph AI with example? So,
sure.
Yeah. Do you want to take it?
No, you wanted to answer.
Yeah, right? I just want to tell you that there's nothing like traditional AI or graph AI. So from whatever I know, I feel that there's narrow AI. So AI which is applied to achieve one task, like speech recognition or object detection or a face recognition, while broader AI is what graph AI is helping us move towards. So that is you are relating your AI model with the graphs. So graphs are derived from your existing data. So that's how I feel it is not like traditional AI or graph AI. All AI are same. It's just that how you apply them and how the AI is evolving. So with that, Kuntal, to you.
No, I mean, that's a nice answer. Maybe I just want to add a sentence. I mean, as Dikti also said, right, there's nothing only for graph AI. AI is a general thing. And, you know, there are some paradigms, some schools, for example, you know, you could have fast order logics, predicate logic, etc., etc., or fuzzy logic or machine learning, deep learning. Graph is just another way to do AI, but it's you know, with some of its specific techniques as like in PGMs and other kind of analysis. But yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it.
Okay, we have one more question from Sanchali Rai. When to choose graph AI over other models?
Okay, so other models is a pretty
I mean,
not
she's
very clear,
actually
I guess.
asking over traditional AI. So I would say, yeah, from a single task, how you want to evolve to broader AI. So you can give an example or explain.
Sure. Okay, so there's no real guideline per se, there's no formally laid out rule, but you know, if you can represent the problem as a graph, or for example, if you see the parameter space is exploding, but there are, you know, sufficient graph properties that can make it more concise, thereby make it more learnable, right, which I also covered in some part of the talk today. So those are situations where you might want to explore. And by the way, if you talk of, you know, today, the way that we know AI of today, a lot, most of the traditional AI of today, as you call it. So if you think of it, there's something called hidden Markov models, which comes from the graph, you know, the probabilistic graphical model paradigm, and a lot of you have heard of it. And then there's something called conditional random fields, which is also kind of part of this stream of exploration. Now, if you think of the recurrent neural networks, which I'm sure is, like, you know, more well known because of the way that deep learning has evolved, but RNNs in a form are recurrent neural networks. I mean, if you, maybe I would suggest it's probably too short a session, but if you read up conditional random fields and then try to look at RNNs, you'll see the obvious similarity between the two, how one almost morphs into the other. So, you know, the boundaries start disappearing beyond a point.
Just to add to what Kuntal is telling, so Sanjali, see traditional AI and graph AI. I'll tell you, in a traditional AI also can do some decisions, okay? But how fast it does the decision is a question mark. So with graph AI, that is your models that you already have, you can actually make it do decisions much faster because this is the data which is existent with you. So Kuntal, is that right?
Well, yes and no, but I mean...
So yeah.
Yeah, but it's a longer topic of discussion.
Correct.
So maybe...
It's a longer topic. Probably you can reach us out. So we gave our view. And Sanjali has asked for one more question right now. K selection ticket distribution on parameters.
I'm sorry, what was the question again?
K selection ticket distribution based on parameters.
I think I'm missing the question somewhere.
Yeah. I think Sanjali, probably you can drop in a mail. We did not understand the question. You are asking about some election ticket case, and you are asking about the distribution model. How do we model it using graph AI? So I'm not sure if I am clear. Okay, she's asking for a case study.
Oh, case study. Okay. Yeah. You know, maybe one of the ways to go is there are a lot of, you know, maybe you can look at Google Scholar. There are lots of these papers that are available, which try to do, you know, graphical models, because again, a case study would be long.
It'll be long to explain. Yes.
So it'll be a set of examples that you have to take, and you have to go through the whole data example. But even the example that I took here, you know, in this session itself, as you see, right, exploring this via the graphs is relatively, you know, intuitive. But I mean, if you have to do a machine learning. Okay, other cases, if you do a machine learning, you need a lot of data here. You know, you might need a lot of data, but I mean, you represent differently,
right?
Think, so,
Kuntal, what she's telling is, in case of elections, okay, if we have to make the AI model predict or something.
Oh, is that what she's asking?
Maybe
I'm sorry.
As an example, I'm telling, okay, if we can relate and explain, probably she'll understand. I think she's looking for some example to relate.
Oh, got it. You know, let's take that offline. Maybe we can post it somewhere because constructing an example will take time.
Sanjali, can you maybe drop in a mail to techetana@gmail.com? Then I will loop in Kuntal as well. Then we'll have a discussion in detail and explain different case studies much more in detail.
Sure.
So, any more questions, guys? So, guys, please do subscribe and thank you for being with us today and thank you for joining the session and thank you, Kuntal, for sharing all your knowledge. It was a very comprehensive session, but yeah, I know for you it is not comprehensive. There's a lot more that you want to share, but if we share too much, I'm not sure people will, might get confused. So maybe we'll do in parts, something like that. Okay, then Sanjali is also asking something. Okay, Sanjali, we'll get back to you. Okay, so guys, please do subscribe, and we are there on YouTube, we are there on Meetup, and you can mail us your questions anytime. Okay, we might take little bit of time to respond because of the many questions that are coming in, but we will do respond, I'm sure about it. Okay, and please do subscribe on YouTube to so that you get a notification whenever we go live, and please support us. Thank you guys, thank you for your time. Before going, there's one more thing left out, I forgot. The most interesting part of the day. So yeah, Kuntal, what is a book that you are reading or you are planning to read or you are thinking of right now?
Hard question. The last year has been a bit too hectic, but the thing is, I have like purchased, have not been able to read yet, hoping to start, is, you know, something by Louis George Boris. It's called Labyrinth. So I hope to start that.
So guys, this is a book. Can you tell me what is this book about? A brief.
Yeah, okay. It's...
See, I'll tell you what. The reason we ask for book is each of our speaker comes from a different background. Okay. So they have a different learning. So, I mean, their view is different. So it will help us also get different view perspective.
What is interesting here, rather than going for the book, is about, let me tell some interesting things. Yeah. Louis, you know, talks a lot of abstract structures, including Library of Babel and so on and so forth. And there are layers of these libraries and so on and so forth. So these are like an abstract structure kind of descriptions that they go in these books. It's not exactly a fiction per se, but not a traditional non-fiction either. So it's like a different genre. So people interested might try to look at this, or at least try to look up the author. So I did a lot of this kind of stuff, and it's not postmodernism either, by the way. So for those who are thinking postmodernism, it's not that either, but it kind of touches upon that also. So it's a mix of a few things.
Okay. Yes. So this is an interesting takeaway. I'm going to go and check this book up. And thank you guys. Thank you for your time. And thank you, Kuntal.
Thanks.
And yeah, and we are logging off. And we'll meet you with another session on July 6th.